And today, the Feast of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. And just a few considerations, taking some of them primarily from St. Bernardino of Siena. And probably some of them just come in. Which is the most Immaculate Heart of Mary is the place, the Feast of the Immaculate Heart, one of the mysterious feasts, is very briefly, because Pius the Ninth and Pius the Seventh instituted the original heart of this feast. But the mystery of it is Pius the Twelfth. And Pius the Twelfth, it's interesting what it says in the breviary, and it's very interesting how unusual this is, a very modern thing that it says. And it says it was originally the Feast of the Pure Heart of Mary, Immaculate Heart of Mary, and then this was established by Pius the Seventh, and Pius the Ninth aggrandized the feast for a local feast. And then Pius the Twelfth, because of the great devotion in his heart. That's what it says in the breviary today. Pius the Twelfth, because of the great devotion in his heart, decided to make this feast for the universal church. And in fact, it's a very modern approach, because it doesn't say that about Pius the Ninth, doesn't say that about Pius the Seventh, and it leaves out a very minor detail. Very minor detail. I'm dealing with a young man recently. He's telling his mother, he said, well, I guess it's not that recent, within the last 10 years, not very recently, several years ago. He said, well, the cops pulled me over, Mom, because I was just going 5 miles over the speed limit. And then they were all vicious and angry, and they arrested me, and left out a minor detail. The minor detail was they just robbed a bank. So he was going 5 miles over the speed limit. He did roll through a stop sign. But there was a little detail that he left out. He had just robbed a bank or robbed a convenience store. I mean, they conveniently left out a detail. And this happened in the breviary today, that Pius XII left out a small detail. We put into the breviary because of the devotion of Pius XII's wonderful heart. The Immaculate Heart of Mary was spread as a devotion throughout the whole world. And he made consecrated the world, the Immaculate Heart, because of the devotion in his heart. He left out a minor detail, and that is two minor details. One is that he was consecrated a bishop on the May the 13th, 1917, the same day in which the Blessed Virgin Mary appeared in Fatima, Portugal. He was consecrated a bishop on that same day in Italy, knowing nothing about the apparition. When he heard about the apparition, he said, oh, I am the Bishop of Fatima. And then he became the Pope, and he called himself the Pope of Fatima. And he firmly believed in Fatima. And the Blessed Virgin Mary requested that the Russia be consecrated to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. But in 1942, in the midst of World War II, the Russians had just joined the Allies and were no longer on the side of the Axis. And he thought it would be inappropriate to consecrate Russia to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. And so he consecrated the whole world to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. And it says that he did it because of devotion in his heart. Well, it was heaven that requested it. And it was because Fatima requested it that he did the consecration of the Immaculate Heart. Well, they did not do according to the request of Fatima because he was afraid of offending the Russians. And so, therefore, Russia was not consecrated to the Immaculate Heart of Mary in 1942. And the war would go on for another 3 years with many millions and millions and millions of innocent people dying because Pope Pius XII did not obey heaven. And yet they put him to the breviary because of the devotion in his heart. We don't see that type of thing written in the breviary about other feasts, but it's written about this one. Meanwhile, there's a sermon taken from St. Bernardino of Siena about the seven succinct and sacred words of the Blessed Virgin Mary. That the Holy Mother, as it says, because she is so holy, because she is so filled with grace, because she is so immaculate and pure, she can say everything in only a few words. And the sacred scripture gives us seven words that she spoke. And notice the power of these words. The seventh word is the word that transformed the entire history of the world. Because before that word, man was in darkness. And before that word, man was not able to be pleasing to God. And the seventh word is, when the Blessed Virgin Mary says only one word, there are two words that she speaks to the angel Gabriel. Her second two words, she speaks to her cousin Elizabeth. And the third two words, the fourth and fifth and sixth word, she speaks to her son. And the seventh and final word, only one word, she speaks to all of humanity. And she says, do whatever he tells you. Not all of humanity, but to the servants. To all humanity, she says, do whatever he tells you. To everyone, she says that. The servants hear the word of Mary, and those that are not servants do not hear the word. And the difference between those that go to heaven and those that go to hell is those that hear the word, do whatever he tells you, coming from the mouth of that woman, they receive strength and power to obey Christ, to obey God, to become great saints, to become martyrs, to carry Christ's truth to the very ends of the earth. One word. But here St. Bernardine points out, how was this word prepared? Before she could speak that word with great power, and she's the mother of God, the mediator of all grace, what did she have to do first? She had to speak six other words. And then the seventh word has power. This is one of the great mistakes that missionaries make, one of the great mistakes that priests make, and the great mistakes that the faithful make also. You speak to your brothers and come back to the church, believe in the true religion. It doesn't work. It's like Bishop Sheen gave the example of two businessmen in Germany working 20 years together, and finally the Protestant businessman was dying, and the Catholic businessman said to his Lutheran brethren who was with him 20 years in business, says, now that you're dying, don't you think you should become a Catholic? And the Lutheran turned to his Catholic friend and said, if your religion was so unimportant to you during these last 20 years of our lives that you never spoke of it once, why should it become important to me now that I am dying? And he died without Christ. If your religion is so unimportant to you that during your life you don't speak of it, why should it become important to me now at my death? And so many souls die without God, die without the truth, die without the faith, die enemies of God, because the only time they're spoken to about God is at their deathbed. By some Catholic that says, oh, by the way, I've been Catholic all my life. I've known you for the last 20 or 30 years. Now you're dying. Why don't you become a Catholic? And they don't listen. And you see, Bernardine points out, well, there's a reason they don't listen. Of course, there will be some souls that will never listen because of the maliciousness of the human heart. But many souls will listen. But what are the conditions before they listen? The six words of Mary. First, she spoke two words to an angel. And her first word was, I do not know man. How could this be since I do not know man? Her first word is, stay away from sin. That's the beginning of being able to preach to others. The beginning to be able to make others into saints and turn them to God. First word, how can this be since I do not know man? And that is purity and staying away from sin. And then the second word is, fiat mihi secundum verbum tuum. Let it be done to me according to thy word. The angel says, Blessed Virgin Mary, you will be the mother of God. Will you accept to be the mother of God? Will you accept God's will for you? Fiat. Let God's will be done. These are the two words spoken to an angel who is a messenger of God. And God uses messengers to help us stay away from sin and messengers to help us know what is his holy will. And then the second two words, that put it into practice of charity. So that she goes to her cousin Elizabeth and she says, Ave Elizabeth. She says to the Blessed Virgin Mary, to Elizabeth, Hail Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth hears the word of Mary, the child, St. John the Baptist, finds Christ. And then, in the presence of Elizabeth, she praises God. This is something very important, especially for ladies, because very often it's a very common thing that we have the custom of gossip. We have the custom of speaking evil about everyone and everything. Evil is always in the face of the tip of our tongue. But what does God want? The only long words that St. Bernardine, she has very short words. There's only once she speaks long. And that when she says, My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, because he that is mighty has done great things unto me, and holy is his name. Notice his name. holiness of God, thanksgiving to God, loving God, communicating about the things of God, and giving thanks to God, and communicating the glory of God, and how wonderful God is. This is what she says in her long words. And how it is that in our speech, of our regular speech, we speak little of God, we don't know much about God, we don't speak of God, and don't give thanks to God. But this is the third word of Mary, fourth word of Mary. She gives thanks to God, and she praises God in her speaking to Elizabeth. And then finally, she speaks two words to her son. They have no wine. Well, first of all, why a father, son hasn't done to us, the father has thought thee sorrowing. She experiences the cross of the 3-day loss. And then she hears the Lord say, you have experienced the cross. You will experience more crosses. But know that the cross happens to us because I am about my Father's business. In order for us to go and accomplish the things of God, we've got to experience bumps and bruises. We've got to experience crosses. We've got to fall down. We've got to have difficulties. And we must understand the crosses that God sends us, that these are strengthening our souls so that we might be about the Father's business. And she pondered these things in her heart. And then she finally said the most powerful word of prayer to her son. They have no wine. All she says is, they have no wine. And because she is so full of grace, and because she is so perfect and so immaculate, when God the Son in human flesh hears those words, he has no choice but to listen to her and to solve the problem and make 120 gallons of wine and fill them with wine and good wine. And then when he is about to perform that miracle, she says her final and seventh word to the servants, do whatever he tells you. We have to tell people in our world today to do what God tells us, to follow God's will, to be faithful to him. But it cannot have power. It will not have its effect if we haven't spoken those first six words. And if we don't have the Spirit of the Blessed Virgin Mary in those six words inside of us, then we can be instruments of heaven to bring souls to God. And all must be instruments. Of course, first of all, the Pope, who's not being an instrument as he should be. Secondly, the bishops. Third, the priests. But also the faithful must also be instruments in order to be communicators of the faith to others with power. And this can't be done unless we speak the first six words. Two words to the angel. Our guardian angel is always there to help us. Two words to an angel. Two words to our neighbor. Words of greeting and words of charity and praising God in the presence of our neighbor. Confessing God before our neighbor. And then two words to Christ. And these two words of our sorrow, speaking to him in our sorrows of our crosses, and speaking to him and begging him to help us. And when then there's the sixth word that says, they have no wine, Christ hears our prayers. Remember what our Lord said, according to thy faith, let it be done unto you. Many people request help, but the help is not given because they don't have faith. You have to travel to the first five words of Mary, and then the sixth word, the request that we make has power. But if we don't travel the first five words, the sixth word does not have power. And then after speaking that sixth word, then we turn to our neighbor and say, do what Christ tells you. Come to the Holy Roman Catholic Church, you that are not Catholic. Come to confession, those that have turned away from the true faith and have gone away from God. Come to the religious life. Come to a Catholic marriage. Come to the life of God. And this coming will have power if Mary's heart is inside of us. And as we travel through life, let's beg the grace that her seven words enter our hearts and give us power to imitate her and be able to be instruments of Mary and the communication of grace to souls in our times. May God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.